Hello everyone. Today I will be doing a lesson on legislative drafting and statutory interpretation. So as evident by the name itself, there are two branches in this subject matter. That is the branch of legislative drafting and the branch of statutory interpretation. So today I will be doing a lesson in the branch of legislative drafting. In fact, the very first lesson, that is introduction to legislative drafting. This is an examinable area and it has been asked as a question in question papers, especially in the 2019 October paper as well. So keeping that in mind, we'll move on with this lesson. So there are three subtopics that I will be talking in this lesson. That is the importance of legislation, the nature of legislation, and the classification of legislation. So first I will be talking about the importance of legislation. So importance of legislation, it's an important source of law, not only for academics, but also for judges, for lawyers, for legal draftsmen, etc. So this has become an important source of law to such an extent that in common law countries today, common law is second to the legislation. That is to say, legislation is considered as more important than common law. Now, it's not only an important source of law, but it has become the most important source of law for academics, practitioners, and draftsmen alike. So that is because legislation affects us from our birth to our death. It affects our education, it affects our health, it affects our job market, it affects our economy, etc. Therefore, when talking about the importance of legislation, it's important to understand that it's an important source of law, and secondly, it's the most important source of law. And thirdly, it also deals with affairs of the government, public corporations, banks, and companies. So, the very basic example is the Constitution. Constitution is a basic example of a form of legislation. So the Constitution has the ability to govern the affairs of the government. It dictates how the government should be made up. It dictates how the government should act, and it dictates what are the powers of the government. So that's the very basic form of legislation. So you can understand how it governs the affairs of the government, public corporations, etc. So Constitution is only a one form of legislation in itself. And fourthly, legislation also deals with transformation of treaty and non-treaty instruments into national legislation. This will be talked for you in another separate subject area, but at this point, it's important to understand that treaties and non-treaty instruments does not become national law or does not become part of the national law upon ratification in dualist states. That is to say, in dualist states, you have to go through a process of transforming treaty and non-treaty instruments into national legislation. Otherwise, it will not apply to your citizens. However, in monist states, this is different. Upon ratification, international treaties and non-treaty instruments become part of the national law. So that is also important to understand that legislation is needed to transform treaty and non-treaty instruments into national legislation. And fifthly, legislation is also important in developmental and economic issues. That is to say, if you want to develop a country, if you have economic issues and if you want to address it, you need appropriate legislation to back up your policies, to back up what you are going to do. So for example, if you want to increase the export economy of the import economy of the country, then there has to be policies, there has to be tax breaks, there has to be incentives, there has to be fiscal incentives. For example, in many countries as well as in Sri Lanka, there are tax breaks for companies who small scale companies who have started their business for the first 5 years of their business. This is also done through legislation. So legislation is also needed for developmental and economic issues. And sixthly, it is essential for the globalization of law, liberalization and regulation of international trade. So keeping that in mind, those are the 6 points that are discussed under the importance of legislation. Keeping that in mind, let us move on to the classification of legislation. So legislation can be classified in 4 ways. So the 4 ways are: there can be primary legislation, there can be subordinate legislation, there can be devolved legislation, and there can be classification of legislation by subject matter. So first we will go on to the primary legislation. So primary legislation means laws that are passed by the parliament. Every act that is passed by the parliament is considered as primary legislation. That is to say, now it can be private acts, it can be public acts. However, they have to, these acts, these primary legislation have to be within the scope of the constitution. It cannot go ultra vires to the constitution. If it does, you have the power to go up to challenge the constitutionality of the act in a court of law. So from 1948 to 1972, challenging the constitutionality of an act was done in the post-enactment stage. That is to say, after the act is enacted, you go to court, you go to a court of law and you file a case saying that this is beyond the scope of the constitution or ultra vires to the constitution. However, since 1972 to up to date, this is done in the pre-enactment stage. That is to say, before the act is enacted, you have to challenge its constitutionality. You cannot today challenge the constitutionality of an act after its enactment, right? So primary legislation, those are laws that are passed by the parliament. Then there is subordinate legislation. Subordinate legislation means laws that are passed by legislative authorities other than the parliament. So it's very easy to understand. Primary means parliament. Subordinate means any other legislative authority other than the parliament. Now, I mentioned before, if the primary legislation is ultra vires to the constitution, you can challenge it. Likewise, if the subordinate legislation goes beyond the scope of the principal act, then you can challenge this goes beyond the scope of the principal act, and you can render the act null and void in a court of law if it goes beyond the scope of the principal act. So subordinate legislation is normally rules, regulations, bylaws, orders, emergency regulations, so etc. So what you need to remember is primary is parliament, subordinate is any other legislative authority other than the parliament. Primary, you go to you challenge it if it is ultra vires to the constitution. Subordinate, you challenge it if it's ultra vires to the principal act, right? So that is in mind also. So in devolved legislation, that is the third classification of legislation, there legislation can be done by either the central government or the provinces of a unitary state. For example, in Sri Lanka, as you all know, after the 13th Amendment, we have a central government and we have devolved the powers of the central government on some provinces. So that is through the Provincial Council Act of 1986. So here we have given the power of devolved legislation to the provinces as well as the central government. That is to say, the central government has the ability to pass, enact legislation, and the provinces also has the ability to enact legislation. However, in countries, in quasi-federal countries like Sri Lanka, provinces are below the powers of the central government, and the central government has the power to control the provinces. It's not a federal government at its best, right? So devolved legislation means you have the center, you have the provinces, the center can enact legislation, the provinces can enact legislation as well. So keeping that in mind, we are going to a question that is Franklin Dam case. We are going to a case that is Franklin Dam case. In the Franklin Dam case, what happened was, the issue was whether a UNESCO treaty regarding archaeological sites should be enacted by the Federal Parliament of Australia or the state legislatures. So, to make it easy for you to understand, it's like whether the central government of Sri Lanka can enact it or whether the provincial government, provincial councils of Sri Lanka can enact it. That is only for your understanding. So, in the Franklin Dam case, it was held that it is only the federal government of Australia that has the power to enact the UNESCO treaty regarding archaeological sites. So, however, a different view or the opposite view was taken in the case of Attorney General of Canada versus Attorney General of Ontario. Then there is legislation by reference to the subject matter. There is the fourth classification. Here, legislation is classified according to the subject matter. That is to say, there is penal legislation. In the penal legislation, it's done in favor of the accused. So, all of you know, until an accused is proven guilty in a court of law, he is assumed to be innocent. So, that itself shows that it's in favor of the accused. Then there is tax legislation that is in favor of the taxpayer. Then constitutional legislation, which works in a manner that the constitution can work. There is human rights legislation, there is finance legislation, etc. So that is legislation by reference to the subject matter. So now we talked about classification. There are four classifications: primary, subordinate, there is devolved, and there is classification by subject matter. So keeping that in mind, let us move on to the final subtopic, that is the nature of legislation. Now, what you need to remember is legislation is the end product of a legislative process or a rulemaking process. That is to say, it's a written law, it's an enacted law, and it's a statute law. Completely different from common law, as I mentioned before, because common law are rules, traditions, laws that have been coming through from generation to generation without being properly codified somewhere. Here it's written, here it's statutory, and here it's enacted law. So, it's codified somewhere. Now, for a very good example, a very basic example, again, is the constitution. In countries like Sri Lanka, the constitution is the primary source of legislation on the law of the land. So, it's an enacted law, it's a statutory and a written law. Right? So, keeping that in mind, the second point on nature of legislation is that legislation cannot be retrospective. It only has the effect of being prospective. That is to say, it looks into the future and not into the past. So, however, it can look into the past in two exceptional situations. Now, basically put, legislation is enacted in the hopes that it will address the issues that will arise in the present, in the future. It is not enacted to address the issues that has already arisen. So, however, there are two exceptions. Those two exceptions are, one, if the legislative provision is made to a retrospective effect by either expressly or impliedly. Or secondly, if it deals with international crimes established by treaties to which Sri Lanka has become a state party through ratification or accession. That is to say, legislation is prospective. It cannot be retrospective. However, there are two exceptional cases. One is if it says expressly that this is retrospective, then it is retrospective. Or two, or if it impliedly states that this is retrospective, that is retrospective. Secondly, if Sri Lanka has signed a treaty or a non-treaty instrument binding them to some international laws, then they are we are bound by that treaty and non-treaty instrument even retrospectively. So there are two very famous cases that regarding these two exceptions. One is the Sepal Ekanayaka versus Attorney General case. In this case, what happened was Sepal Ekanayaka hijacked an aircraft and he made some demands regarding that his wife and children be delivered to him and some money being delivered to him. So anyway, at that time that this case happened or these incidents took place, we as Sri Lankans did not have a law regarding aviation safety and hijacking. So we did not have any law to make Sepal Ekanayaka to punish the accused. So what the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka stated was, Supreme Court of Sri Lanka stated that offences relating to hijacking and aviation safety under the Tokyo, Hague and Montreal conventions to which we have signed as a country apply with retrospective effect under Article 13 of the 1978 Constitution. So Article 13(6) of the 1978 Constitution states that when a person commits an act which is not an offence under the local legislation, but is an offence under the law of the nation, then that legislation may apply to such person retrospectively. So therefore, we were able to put out a punishment for the accused. So the second case that is important is the Queen versus Lienage case. In Queen versus Lienage, there was a military attempted military coup against the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka at that time. So what happened was, although it was attempted, it was not successful, and the Prime Minister was able to identify the accused and then take them into custody. So what the Prime Minister did was she brought forward an act which enabled her to confiscate the property of the accused, to deprive them of their right to trial by jury, as well as that act brought forward a minimum sentence. That is to say, you have to go to jail for this minimum sentence. So now the accused in this case, what they did was they appealed to Privy Council, saying that this is an ultra-vires to the Constitution. And the Privy Council stated that yes, this is a purposefully bought an act which was enacted by the Parliament and which offends the doctrine of separation of powers and therefore is ultra-vires to the Constitution. And therefore, this act cannot apply to these people. So even though the act was enacted in the past, the decision affected these people retrospectively. Right? So keeping that in mind, the third nature of legislation is that legislation cannot fall into disuse or obsolescence. That is to say, outdated legislation is not implemented generally. For example, the bread ordinance is there, but we do not use it. We do not implement it. However, it does not fall into disuse or obsolescence in theory. However, legislation can be dead law. It can be dead if it is rendered null and void by a court of law. Unless done so, no matter if we do not use it for 100 years, it still applies. It does not fall into disuse or obsolescence until it's considered null and void by a court of law. Right, so keeping these things in mind, then you have to understand the legislative process. The legislative process is threefold. There is the parliamentary stage, there is the pre-parliamentary stage, there is the parliamentary stage, and there is the post-parliamentary stage. In the parliamentary stage, the legislative drafter can enhance the quality of the legislation. How can he do so? He can do so by an impact assessment. He can do so by impact assessment, in that he can expose the legislation to public consultation. For example, in 2008 in UK, the Human Fertilization and Embryology Act was subjected to wide public consultation in light of scientific development. So this is very good, because at the end of the day, the legislation will affect the people. So if the people has a chance to give their own opinion about what is going to affect them, then it's good. So public consultations is a very good method of enhancing the quality of legislation that can be done in the pre-parliamentary stage. And you can ask the opinion of knowledgeable people in the area of the legislation. So for example, on the draft bill on Securities Exchange Act of 2018, it was made available to people who had interest in capital markets. So people, legislative drafters are draftsmen. They do not have every knowledge about everything on the planet Earth. However, they can take advantage of the knowledgeable people in those areas by asking about their opinion, whether the terms are right, whether this will apply in real life, or whether this is just theory. So public consultation as well as specific knowledgeable people is also important in the pre-parliamentary stage. In the parliamentary stage, the parliamentary stage begins with the tabling of a draft bill in the parliament by entering it in the order paper. When you enter the draft bill in the order paper, what happens is the matter will be talked in the parliament, and in the parliament the legislative drafter has to appear before the oversight committee, and he has to incorporate what has been told to him by the relevant ministry or the ministers in the act as in the legislation as well. Also, now as I mentioned before, you can challenge the constitutionality of a legislation in the pre-enactment stage. So the pre-enactment stage is the pre-parliamentary stage. In the pre-parliamentary stage, if the Supreme Court states that that the legislation is intravias to the constitution, then you can proceed. However, if they say that it's ultravias to the constitution, you have to make the necessary adjustments to make it intravias to the constitution, and that is done in the parliamentary stage. Also, at this stage, legislative drafters in this stage, there is the committee stage. At this stage, legislative drafters must incorporate and the amendments made to the draft bill by the members of the parliament. So at this stage, you cannot go to a court of law for the constitutionality of a draft bill. However, if it raises constitutional matters, then the Attorney General can rule on the constitutionality of a committee stage amendment. Now, that is parliamentary stage. In the parliamentary stage, what you have to do is you can incorporate the amendments made, opinions given by the Supreme Court. You can incorporate the amendments made by the members of the parliament, and you can incorporate the amendments made by the oversight committee. Right. So then in the post-parliamentary stage, is also important as the other two stages. In this stage also, you can enhance the quality of the legislation. So legislative drafters should participate in the making of rules, regulations, orders and bylaws to give effect to the principles and provisions of an act of parliament. That is to say, if you enact a legislation without any way of empowering, without that legislation working, then it will not have any use. Therefore, you have to have rules, regulations, laws, orders that make it possible for the legislation to work. For example, and at this stage, it's a good practice if you establish citizen committees. That is to say, legislative drafters have to have the understanding of what the citizens think about this legislation, because as I mentioned before, at the end of the day, it affects the citizens. So by establishing citizen committees, you ensure that the legislation is not too far-fetched to work in the practical life. Right, so that is the post-parliamentary stage. So that is the lesson on introduction to legislative drafting. There is the importance of legislation, there is nature of legislation, and there is classification of legislation. All three are equally important, as these have been examinable. So I hope you understood what I did in this lesson, and thank you.